Hi friends, welcome to Crazy for DB. In this tutorial, we are going to understand the very basics of Oracle's backend programming language, that is PLSQL. With all the other very important aspects of PLSQL, I will also lead you to write our first program of adding two numbers. This will lay a foundation for your further study of PLSQL. So I suggest you watch this video until end without skipping any part. Meanwhile, you may also subscribe to this channel with a click on bell icon to stay tuned with this channel for future updates. So now we start. PLSQL language, as the Oracle has called it, as a procedural language extension to the SQL. Though it is a proprietary language to Oracle, that is, this language you won't find in any other database systems, but only in Oracle. But as a language of similar structure exists with different names in other databases also, hence studying PLSQL is worth so that you can work in other database systems with whatever same language they have, but with different names. PLSQL and the other databases which have equivalent of this PLSQL, the syntax and structure is more or less the same. Now the question obviously arises, why we need a language like PLSQL? Now when we deal with relational database management system like Oracle, the convention is to use only one language, which is non-procedural, and that is obviously SQL. This is an obvious question, but then it could not have been there without its need either. So unless and until there is a need, how can the PLSQL language itself should exist or should have been made? So I enumerate a few points why we need PLSQL. The first point that I say here is to push the data processing to backend where data resides. It means that in a client server environment where the database is accessed by the users from the terminals, the backend is obviously the database, and on the front end there is an application. The processing of the data is shifted to the backend with the help of PLSQL, so that the processing is done at the same end where the data exists, and so there is no flow of data required over the net from server to the client or from server to the terminal. Say for example, if I am supposed to find a maximum value, and for the time being just think that max function doesn't exist. We have studied the max function in the SQL part of this channel, but if there is no max function available, then probably that program would have been written in the front end, and the entire data from the back end, from the tables, would have been required to be taken to the front end, and so the entire data would require to travel from the back end to the front end, causing the bottleneck in the internet, and obviously there will be some performance issues associated with it. And so it is worthwhile to push the data processing to back end where the data resides. So that is the first important reason why there is PLSQL. Then the second reason is, as you can see over here, is for security of the data. And again, I am talking about to avoid the flow of SQL and also the data. In the client server environment, if the SQL is getting fired from the client and is hitting to the server, it is possible that until it hits the server is in the form of a plain simple string, because SQL is a statement, and so it is exposed to hacking, it is exposed to be intercepted in between, and there is a phenomena, or there is a practice, bad practice you can say, called as SQL injection. And it is possible that whatever data as a result of that SQL will flow from the server to the client will equally be tapped in between. And so for the security reasons, we can use the PLSQL which resides at the backend. Only the call to that program written in the PLSQL goes from the front end to the back end, and so there is no SQL flow, there is no SQL injection. Of course, that is a very ideal case, but we can in a way prevent to a large extent the SQL injection from the application. Now the third reason for why PLSQL exists is as an envelope for several related statements, I say. Remember that when we perform any activity, it is possible that an activity might require say 2, 3, 4, 5 of the SQL statements, and instead of writing those SQL statements scattered somewhere, you can put that in a PLSQL program as an envelope, because all of them are doing supporting tasks for each other and collectively producing a final result. So PLSQL can act as an envelope for the multiple related SQL statements. So that is also one reason why PLSQL exists. Actually, there are not just three reasons that I have enumerated here. There can be hundreds of such reasons, but we have to limit ourselves to these three important from the interview point of view. Now, after answering the question why PLSQL, now we need to know some very important features of PLSQL as a language, because this is the first lesson in the PLSQL, and we are getting exposed to PLSQL for the first time. We need to know the most important features of the PLSQL. The first important point here is PLSQL borrows its structure from ADA. Actually, ADA is a language which was suggested some 400 years ago and was supposed to be a language for Charles Babbage's engine, but it was actually never created. But even at that point of time, the concept of this language was created by the lady named ADA, and so the language name also is ADA. PLSQL actually borrows its structure from the ADA language. Now, what is there in the ADA language to borrow the structure from? PLSQL is a block structured language, as I said. It is a block structured language which has a definite starting point and ending point. You see, block structure basically imparts modularity to this language. That is very important. You can write for every small functionality a simple block and separate blocks, and then assemble those blocks so that we can create a big application. So PLSQL basically is a block structured language. We will see that this block is extremely disciplined block. The structure of the block we will see shortly. Then the next important point is PLSQL is tightly integrated with SQL and Oracle database. Yeah, this is another important point. As you can see, tightly integrated with SQL and Oracle database means it can take the SQL statements directly. If you try to write SQL statements, say, in some other language, say VB or something like that, then you will, or Java, you will require an API like JDBC or ODBC, something like that. But here you don't require an API, so it does not need an API, that is application programming interface. That is a mediator between the database and the application. You don't require PLSQL, because it is tightly integrated with SQL and the Oracle database. The communication between them is direct, and so is most efficient. The next point that we can see is PLSQL offers object-oriented capabilities. It is an object-oriented language also. From Oracle 8i version, the object-oriented capabilities were introduced in PLSQL, and so now, because of this object-oriented capability imparted by the PLSQL to the Oracle database, instead of just RDBMS, Oracle has become ORDBMS, that is Object Relational Database Management System. We will keep on studying until the end, and then we will sometime also reach to the study of PLSQL capabilities of as object-oriented language. Then next is PLSQL offers ability to handle exceptions. This is very important in the modern days programming, because there can be runtime errors, and those runtime errors are required to be handled. Particularly, PLSQL being a backend programming language, any errors which handle at the back end must be must save the program from crashing, because crashing of the program abnormally in the back end can confuse the front end program, because there is always it is possible that a different language may be there in the front end, like Java or something like that. And so PLSQL offers excellent ability to handle exception, is very important feature of the PLSQL. PLSQL uses the same data types as the database. This is actually very much advantageous, because the exchange of the data between a PLSQL program and the database becomes very easy because of this data type being same at both the ends. So these are the very important PLSQL features, as you can see over here. Now PLSQL is written, how basically is the structure of the PLSQL that we need to see. The PLSQL blocks, actually they come in two forms. It is written in two forms. One is called as the anonymous block, that is what exactly we are going to use in the beginning. And then secondly, it can be in the form of a named or stored subprogram. As the word anonymous suggests, anonymous blocks do not have the names. They cannot be called as such, and they do not have the names. They are not permanently stored in the database. Actually, their nature is that you write a PLSQL anonymous block, you submit it, then it is immediately submitted to the compiler, it is compiled, and then immediately it starts executing. So that is the nature of the anonymous block. Now what should be the use of this block? They cannot be integrated with the application, and the use is only to demonstrate functionality during the development life cycle. So if your user wants to incorporate some functionality, he is asking for some functionality to be present in the application, and so during the development life cycle, it is possible that the developer and the client who wants the application to be developed need to exchange thoughts. And if some requirement has been given to you by the user, you can show whether the requirement can be satisfied with the PLSQL, and in what form it can be satisfied, whether it serves the purpose of for which the client wants to get this application developed. Then obviously during the development life cycle, the anonymous blocks are okay, but as I said that they cannot be integrated with the application as they don't have any name. But then we are going to write the named or stored subprograms. They are stored in the interpretation form, that is important. It is not in the fully compiled form. Basically it is stored as a code, and then when you want to run, actually this code, which is by default stored in the data dictionary, is internally run through an interpreter rather than a compiler. Of course Oracle provides a compiler also, but that has to be integrated separately. That is called as wrapping. And but by default these PLSQL blocks run in the interpretation mode. Now this PLSQL block in the form of named subprograms obviously are meant to be integrated with an application, because they have names and they can be stored in the database. So you have to write those blocks for a certain functionality for once, and then at any point where you need to call them, because they have names, you can call them. The named subprograms actually take different forms, as I have said over here. Like they can be in the form of procedures, functions, they can be package, triggers, object type. So these are the different forms taken by the named subprograms. We are going to learn all of them. We will first of course study the concepts with anonymous blocks, and then we proceed to write the named or stored subprograms shortly. Now here I am writing a small PLSQL program, that is our first PLSQL program, and demonstrate the different features of PLSQL and the basic structure of the PLSQL block. Here I am considering the problem write a program to add two numbers. That is a very simple example I am taking, and this is the code of that program. First let me execute this code. We will take this code to the Oracle environment. This is Oracle SQL Star Plus client provided by Oracle. This is the command line client where I am going to now paste this program entirely, and we will execute it over there. First I will show you the execution. I will insert, say, first value say 125, and then second value say 375, and let us see what is the output of it. It says that sum equals to 500 is the output, and that indicates that PL SQL procedure successfully completed. Now let us understand the flow of this program and also the structure of this block. The block is actually divided into three different sections. So there is this first section that I have highlighted over here. This section is called as the declaration section. Declaration section, basically this is a discipline language. You cannot declare a variable or anything that is required to be declared anywhere in the program. A declaration section is there in the top and always is always on the top, and anything that you want to declare has to be declared in this section only. You cannot declare it anywhere else. Here what you can declare is, there is a long list of the things that you can declare in the declaration section. You can declare variables, you can declare constants, you can declare cursors, we can declare exceptions, you can declare pragmas. There are so many things required to be declared. We will see one by one each of them. Right now we are only seeing these three variables being declared of number type, with all of them having precision 3, that is 3-digit width. Then this part following the declaration section is executable section. Executable section is the most mandatory section. Obviously declaration section is not mandatory, because if your program does not need any declaration, you can omit the declaration section. But obviously you are writing the program to do something, and so the executable section is mandatory. It has to be there, and so executable section is there, which consists of assignments, then code for loop, and then code for conditional control structures, and all the executable forms of statements are there. You can see that x colon equals to ampersand a like statement is there. We need to have some explanation for this. X, that is our variable declared. Colon equals to is assignment. Simple equals to is comparison in the PL SQL, whereas colon equals to is assignment. And then you can see something very strange over here, that is ampersand a. A has not been declared as a variable, but it's preceded with ampersand. Now what does it mean? Actually this is called a substitution variable. Substitution variable basically is a facility provided by SQL Star Plus tool. You see that because of this ampersand a, this type of prompts, as you can see, enter value of a, this type of prompts are automatically getting created. Because PL SQL was never developed as an interactive language, it is a backend programming language to interact with some front end, and actually the front end interacts with the user. So it is not directly interactive language with the user, and so for the testing of the programs in the backend, we need to have some facility like this where we can input the values and test the program. And so this ampersand provision has been made. Actually you can see here that it says enter the value for a. This a is a substitution variable. Why substitution? Because it is actually substituting for a, so that a has accepted the value 125 and then has assigned it to x. That is why a is called as a substitution variable. So that is the explanation of the statements like x colon equals to ampersand a. Y colon equals to ampersand b is a similar statement where the value will be collected by b and will be assigned to the variable y. Then this is the third statement, executable over there, which will calculate the sum, because we are writing the program for adding two numbers x and y. and so the sum of x plus y will be assigned to the z. Then this is dbms underscore output dot put line with the prompt sum equals to, then these two vertical bars are concatenation, and then the z value is concatenated and is displayed. Remember that this statement is somewhat equivalent to printf statement in C, but it actually consists of two parts. I will explain. DBMS underscore output is a package, a built-in package, whereas put line is a procedure in that package which is used for sending the output to the screen. So it is like printf statement. So this is actually the combination of package and the procedure in that package, and so there is a dot in between used as a qualifier for the put line, that is DBMS underscore output, that is package name. Then sum equals to z, that is actually the result being produced here. Sum equals to 500 because the sum of the values that we have entered, 125 and 375, is 500. Then there is exception because this program was didn't raise any exception, and so it did not enter into this, but the exception section is there at the bottom. You can see that it says when value underscore error, then you might wonder from where I brought this value underscore error. It is actually a built-in exception and is used for the error conditions when the values are not compatible with the variables, and so if an exception is raised, we want to display the message to the user that value incompatible with the variable. And so if there would have been any problem with this, I will actually execute this program again. I can execute this program just by putting the slash, because the last executed PLSQL program goes into the buffer of SQL star plus. So I can do that. I will just put slash, and again it will ask for the value. Now I am putting the value, say 800, and then for the value of B I will put in say 430, and you will see that there is an exception raised. The reason being is that because Z has been declared as number 3, and when this assignment is getting done over here, the Z cannot accommodate a value which is 4 digit, as the sum of 800 plus 430 is going to be 4 digit, and so the exception is raised at this statement. Remember that once an exception is raised, Oracle will directly jump the control to the exception handler to find an appropriate exception handler for the current error, that is the value error in this case. And so this message, value incompatible with the variable, okay, is printed over there. And end actually marks the end of the block. And remember that there is a semicolon at the end. One important rule I wanted to tell you is that this declare, this begin, and this exception, they did not have any semicolon at the end. So the general rule is that any keyword with which a section begins or which marks the beginning of a section does not have a semicolon at its end. This rule you will have to remember and will follow throughout the study of PLSQL. Here every declaration is ending with the semicolon, so also every executable statement has to end with the semicolon. So that is actually the structure of the block of the PLSQL explained to you. I hope you must have understood it by now. So friends, keep visiting for more lessons of PLSQL. But before you start studying the PLSQL, my advice is to also study the SQL very well. Over this same channel, you will find a lot of SQL related videos uploaded. Go through them, all the videos, and if you have any doubts, then put those doubts in the comment section, and expect in the reasonable time to get the answers. Thanks for watching.